Good afternoon, I'm Professor José Luis Jiménez from the University of Colorado, and I'm going to present a brief introduction to the COVID-19 aerosol transmission estimator. You can find the estimator at this link, tinyurl.com/covid-estimator. You can find a lot more information about how to protect yourself from aerosol transmission at this other link, tinyurl.com/faqs.aerosol, and that has been compiled by many other scientists and myself. And I've given many talks and interviews, and if you look up my Twitter account at jlj.colorado, you can find links to many of those. So what are we trying to model? We're trying to model infection in a situation in which we share room air, so such as in this picture. So here, some people may be infected and they are exhaling aerosols that contain the virus that are gonna float in the air, just like a smoke, and they're gonna be mixed in the room. And a person which is socially distanced from the smokers may still get infected over time by inhaling this aerosol, this virus-containing aerosol for which we use the smoke as an analog. We are not simulating two things. We're not simulating if you are talking very close to someone, then the probability of infection will be higher because the concentration of the aerosols and the virus will be much higher. Okay, so that's not included in the model. And we're also assuming that people are keeping good hand hygiene. So the model is what we call a box model in atmospheric chemistry or indoor air. We basically are doing a conservation of viruses, conservation of mass, if you will, within a box. And we assume we have an infective person who's exhaling these virus-containing aerosols that are filling the room relatively quickly. And then the viruses may lose infectivity over an hour or two. It may deposit to the ground slowly, but again, over a few hours. Or if they may leave the room through ventilation. In the clean air comes from outdoors that doesn't have the virus, and the air from indoors that has the virus goes outside. And then we have a susceptible person, and we apply the Wells-Rayleigh model of infection, which tells us what the probability of the person being infected is. And that's a model that was developed for measles and tuberculosis, and also works for COVID-19. We also calculate the concentration of carbon dioxide of CO2. This is a very useful indicator because when someone is exhaling the virus, they are also exhaling CO2. And many of the processes that affect the virus, such as ventilation or such as being breathed in by someone else, also affect CO2. The analogy is not perfect, and we have written a paper about it, but this is still very useful because we have devices such as this one that cost only between $100 and $200 with NDIR technology that can measure CO2 very well. And outdoors, we see something like 400 parts per million. And in a poorly ventilated location, a car in this case, we have more than 4,000, meaning 10% of the air that we were breathing for the second time. And then when we started ventilating, the concentration went down a lot. So this is why it's useful to know what the CO2 concentration is. So let's look at the estimator itself. It's a Google spreadsheet. It has a series of tabs. In the README tab, you can find a lot of information and links, videos, descriptions, limitations of the model, and some of the parameters. In the FAQ page, you can find many frequently asked questions about the estimator itself. But the most important are a series of spreadsheets where we can do the calculations. I'm going to show the one for the choir, which is the calculations for the Skagit choir that we have written a paper on. And we are going to have inputs in orange and less important inputs in yellow and the outputs in blue. So we have to tell the model how big is the room that we are considering, how long are the people there, how many times are doing this event, what's the ventilation rate, are we doing additional things such as having HEPA filters or things like that, how many people are present, how many of them may be immune, what type of activity and thus how many viruses are coming into the air, what masks people are wearing, and what the probability of people being infected is. So we have to choose, and the README file tells us how to choose the parameters. And then we get two types of results. One is the conditional results for one event, in which it tells us in this case, 88% of the people will be infected, which is what actually happened at this event. And it also tells us that the concentration of CO2 was about 2,500 ppm, which is a very high level, indicating the low ventilation. In this conditional result, we're assuming someone was infected in that. We also have this absolute result in which we don't know if someone was infected. We assume that we have the same probability as anyone in the population at that time, in that location. And in this case, the probability is much lower because a lot of the time, no one is in there that's infected. And the most useful thing with this model is to calculate the effect of control measures. And this was an example done by El País, which is very famous. We have a situation of a family gathering, someone was infected in there. And then if no control measures were taken, everyone would get infected. But if they start wearing masks and ventilating, then much fewer people got infected. And that's really what the model is most useful for. And thank you very much for your attention.